Good evening. Thanks for joining us. We begin with breaking news. Just 5 days after the president announced on Twitter the date and location for his summit with North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un, North Korea is threatening to cancel it. Now, the summit still may happen June 12th in Singapore, as the president announced just days ago, but there's certainly a new dose of doubt tonight. North Korea suspended talks with South Korea and says that the United States should carefully consider the fate of the summit because of what it calls provocative military disturbances with South Korea. They're referring to a joint military drill conducted by South Korea and the U.S., an exercise called Max Thunder, involving the United States Air Force and South Korean forces, with about 2,000 troops participating, according to the Department of Defense. Now, North Korea is calling the drill a, quote, deliberate provocation. North Korea's threat to call off the summit caught the White House certainly off guard today, according to aides. State Department spokesperson Heather Nauert took the podium for a briefing just as the reports were coming in.
Kim Jong-un had said previously that he understands the need and the utility of the United States and the Republic of Korea continuing in its joint exercises. They're exercises that are legal. They're planned well in advance. We have not heard anything from that government or the government of South Korea to indicate that we would not continue conducting these exercises or that we would not continue planning for our meeting between President Trump and Kim Jong-un next month.
So a surprise at the State Department and in the White House, Roberto Sanchez joins us tonight. So what was the reaction? How surprised was the White House about this announcement today?
Hey there, Anderson. Yeah, apparently they were blindsided by this news from North Korea that the regime planned to cancel talks with South Korea, and that warning from the North Koreans that they may cancel altogether the planned meeting with President Donald Trump in Singapore about a month from now. Sources indicating that aides were completely caught off guard. One senior administration official actually telling us that the president found out about this development through news reports that they didn't hear this directly from Pyongyang or even from Seoul. And perhaps this sort of showcases just how unexpected this news is, the idea that there had been this recent momentum moving toward that summit, acts of good faith on both sides, whether President Trump calling Kim Jong-un smart and gracious, or Kim Jong-un releasing those American prisoners and allowing the return to the United States last week. It really underscores something that we've heard from critics and skeptics within the administration, including National Security Advisor John Bolton, who over the weekend pointed out the history here, the fact that there have been previous deals made with North Korea before that they have ultimately violated, Anderson.
They've now issued a statement, correct, the White House?
Oh, they have, yeah. It took some time, frankly. Apparently, the communications shop was consulting with the Department of Defense as well as with the National Security Council. Ultimately, here's the statement put out by Press Secretary Sarah Sanders. She writes, quote, "We are aware of the South Korean media report. The United States will look at what the North Korean, or rather what North Korea has said independently and continue to coordinate closely with our allies." Clear here that the administration understands they have to walk a very fine line if they still want this summit to happen. Also notable because President Trump has been so brash going back several months in his language about North Korea. He did have a chance, multiple chances, to answer reporters' questions today as he went to visit with the First Lady at Walter Reed Medical Center after she underwent a successful operation yesterday. He returned here to the White House without answering our questions, Anderson.
All right, Boris, thanks very much. Joining me now for his take on all this, retired Rear Admiral John Kirby, who served as the spokesman for both the State Department and Pentagon during the Obama administration. So I'm wondering, Admiral, how big a deal is this? I mean, could it be just a bit of brinksmanship, North Korea trying to improve their negotiating power?
Well, first, we have to admit that we don't actually know what's in Kim's mind, and so we have to caveat everything by not having perfect knowledge and intelligence of what he's actually trying to do. I do not think that this will torpedo the summit. I don't think it was intended to. I think, you know, just talking to Korea experts myself, that this was a way for him to protest the exercises without doing so in a way that actually puts the summit at great risk. And he can punish South Korea, which he did by canceling the meeting. And if you look at the language in that statement, it's pretty bellicose about the South, not so bellicose about the United States. So I think this was a way for him to get on record that he doesn't like these exercises, but not do it in a way that really takes everything down with it.
Does it make sense to you that this is happening ostensibly over military exercises, frankly, that happen every year, and ones that Kim Jong-un seemingly, you know, seemed flexible about earlier this year?
Right, Anderson, great question. And we have to look at not just what he did today, but what he didn't do. He didn't fire off a bunch of missiles. Last year, at this time when we did these two exercises, you remember, Anderson, he launched, I think, 6 or 7 missiles into the ocean and was correspondingly, you know, very bellicose in his rhetoric. He hasn't done that. I mean, we've been doing Full Eagle now for over a month. This exercise just started, but we've been exercising, and there's been no reaction. It's been very mute. And he released 3 Americans in the midst of these exercises. So we have to keep it in perspective of what he's not doing. And that's why I don't think he's really trying to torpedo the summit.
North Korea says that the exercises are ruining the diplomatic mood. I'm not sure how one gauges that, but I'm not sure, even surely what that means.
Yeah, I don't know either. I mean, again, this is typical for them. This is something that they've done before, and they've, you know, reacted harshly. I don't know what he means by that in terms of mood. Clearly, I think what he's trying to say is that the exercises, which are designed in his mind to threaten him, are not in keeping with the spirit of diplomacy and moving towards peace. And look, I mean, if you look at it from his perspective, you can kind of see. I mean, he views the United States as an existential threat. So exercising American capabilities on the other side of the border, you can understand where he's coming from. We know that they're defensive in nature. But I don't think he's trying to ratchet it up too high.
It's also interesting, the idea that the administration, you know, was caught off guard by this.
Yeah.
It does give you a sense of the... You know, it's not like there's a hot phone between the president and Kim Jong-un as there was during, you know, the Cold War in the Soviet Union.
Yes, but, and I agree with you 100%, but Pompeo has now started to develop relationships. And one of the advantages of summits and negotiations, such as we learned with Iran, is you can open up back channels of communication. Mm-hmm. So there were channels that could have been used here for them to protest things. That's why I think doing it in a press release the way they did was really meant more a bit of brinkmanship, a bit of showmanship, kind of slapping South Korea around and making it clear that he's not going into this summit anything other than clear-eyed.
Yeah. Admiral Kirby, thanks very much. As we've noted, we're being unpredictable. There's absolutely nothing new when it comes to North Korea. Joining us tonight is New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman, author of the book, Thank You for Being Late, An Optimist's Guide to Thriving in the Age of Accelerations. I spoke to him just before the broadcast. Tom, with North Korea warning the U.S. over the fate of the summit, I mean, should anybody really be surprised that the road to the summit is not going to be an easy one?
Well, you know, Anderson, when you think about North Korea, you think, how many times have they sold this carpet of denuclearization? At least to 3 different presidents, I believe. So one would have been shocked if this hadn't happened. One would be even more shocked if the deal comes off, and one will be truly bowled over if they actually agree to a verifiable denuclearization plan. I've just never known where the bottom of the story was, but I keep coming back to the fact they have sold this carpet at least 3 times before.
Yeah, I mean, this is we have seen this time and time again with the North Koreans. What do you think their calculus is?
You know, it's really hard to know. They clearly are feeling some pressure. If there is one meeting, Anderson, in the world, I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall on. It would have been the meeting between Xi Jinping, the president of China, and the Kim Jong-un, the leader of North Korea. They had 2 meetings now in the last month. And you really have to wonder, what was Xi Jinping saying to him? Was he saying, hey, you got to denuclearize? Or was he saying, President of North Korea, we love Korea so much, we always wanted there to be 2 of them. You're not going to do anything crazy, are you? Like denuclearize and merge with the South. So the Chinese, I think, have very mixed emotions on this. They'd like the Americans out, but at the same time, they do not want a unified Korea on their peninsula. As we felt about Germany during the Cold War, China feels about Korea. They love it so much, they want there to be 2 of them.
I'm wondering also what the calculus of Kim Jong-un is, or what their opinion is when they look at the United States. I mean, obviously, you've seen President Trump, you know, withdrawing from the Iran agreement, TPP, obviously making very, very bellicose statements, which a lot of people credit for getting Kim Jong-un to the table. How do you see that?
I would say he could draw 1 of 2 conclusions. One is, my God, I mean, the Iranians struck a nuclear deal with him, and the guy welched on it. What's going to happen to me? I better be doubly careful. That's one direction he could go. The other is if he's been watching Trump on China trade, the fact that Trump, you know, just over the weekend on his own tweeted that we have to worry about jobs in China now, and we have to not sanction this Chinese company that violated in a really bad way our trade export laws, sending equipment to, I believe, North Korea and Iran. he might think Trump's a chump. And that if I get in a room with him, he'll be so hungry for a deal to make history. He'll be so panting for a Nobel Prize. Maybe I can outmaneuver him. Think about it, really. Kim Jong-un and Donald Trump negotiating in Singapore. What could go wrong?
It is kind of stunning when you consider just how much kind of the visual of this is important to North Korea, just to be seen. I mean, this is something that they have always wanted, to be one-on-one with the president of the United States. So for them, that's a great victory, whether or not anything comes out of it. And I guess President Trump, who certainly likes a big show, who likes that big presentation, gets something out of it, even if, you know, the details that later are worked out don't really pan out.
I think there's a difference. Kim Jong-un can completely control the spin on the story when he goes back to North Korea. Ain't no CNN there. Donald Trump can't. And if Donald Trump comes back empty-handed, I think he would be eviscerated, not only by his opponents, but by some of his allies in the Republican Party.
But even if there's a quote-unquote agreement after a day or 2 days of meeting between the two men, I mean, the details on something like that, that has to be worked out over weeks and weeks, but with lots of people and moving parts.
Can you imagine the verification? Well, just think about the verification regime we put in place in Tehran, how complicated that was, how many months it took for our Secretary of Energy at the time, Ernie Moniz, a physicist, to work out and oversee the fine-grained details of that so there could be no cheating. Imagine what you'd need in North Korea, an even less transparent country.
It's also starting to have heard the President of the United States call Kim Jong-un honorable.
Yeah, that doesn't bother me really so much, Anderson. I mean, he's building him up. He's building up his ego. That probably comes out of some CIA report, how to soften him up. And Trump can be very good at that. I mean, look, I want to be very clear. If he could somehow maneuver him into giving up his nuclear weapons in a verifiable way, that would be a wonderful thing. Wonderful thing for the world. Great for America. And Donald Trump would deserve a Nobel Prize for that. I'm all for it. But just one has to really be skeptical, given, as I said, how many times the North Koreans have sold that carpet.
We're going to have more of my talk with Tom Friedman in our next hour. But first, more breaking news. The New York Times just now reporting that both the Justice Department and the FBI are investigating Cambridge Analytica, that now defunct political data firm that was accused of misusing the personal data from millions of Facebook users. I'll talk to one of the reporters from the Times who broke the story. Plus, a federal judge rules that the special counsel's case against former Trump campaign manager Paul Manafort can proceed. A significant development. Details. We have breaking news from the New York Times tonight. It is reporting that both the Justice Department and the FBI are investigating the now defunct political data firm Cambridge Analytica. Now, you'll remember the company worked both for the President Trump's election campaign as well as other Republican candidates in 2016. It's come under fire for allegedly misusing the Facebook data of millions of users. Matthew Rosenberg shares the byline of the story, joins us now on the phone. So talk to me about what you've learned about this investigation.
It looks like it's in its early stages. We know that at least two DOJ prosecutors who specialize in financial fraud and an FBI agent who we believe is deals with cyber crimes went to London earlier this month to question at least one witness, possibly more. And look, that speaks to a significant investigation here. Prosecutors are not brought in for fishing expeditions. They're brought in to possibly build cases. People who have been questioned or contacted have been told that there is an open investigation involving Cambridge Analytica and associated U.S. persons, as they put it. They're not clear on who exactly that is.
Is it clear to you what the focus of the investigation is? I mean, what is what's the allegation?
I mean, that's the thing. So officially, the Justice Department and the FBI just won't comment. Given the people involved and the fact they've also reached out to banks that did business with Cambridge Analytica, they seem to be looking into some financial issues. The cyber kind of component would possibly, there have been allegations of hacking. And there is, of course, the harvesting of data, the use of the data, of how they obtained data from Facebook and how they used it. And this kind of runs parallel to another investigation that's going on in Britain by their National Crime Agency, which is looking into hacking, which is looking into destruction of evidence, and a whole range of kind of issues.
Now, is this connected to the Mueller probe at all?
So that's not clear to us. We know that the Mueller's people from Mueller's team questioned two Cambridge Analytica executives in December. We don't know what went beyond that. Mueller's team is obviously pretty tight-lipped. And exactly what the relationship here and if there is any just isn't clear right now.
And I understand the investigators have contacted Facebook as well.
They have. And look, I think I want to be clear that the people we've spoken to and Facebook don't appear to be targets of this investigation. These are potential witnesses. It would be natural to be in touch with Facebook. The data was taken from them, and they would know a lot about it and have a lot to provide and possibly add there.
And in the introduction to you, we mentioned the company did work for the Trump campaign and other Republican candidates. Do you know if the investigation touches either the Trump campaign or any campaign at all?
So that's also, you know, one of the big questions here. Look, the company was owned. The U.S. people who owned the company were Robert Mercer and his daughter, Rebecca. Its vice president was Stephen K. Bannon. You know, these guys have tremendous influence in Republican politics, and any investigation into the company is they are going to be drawn into it.
So, I mean, the bottom line of this hour, and, you know, as you said, rightly, there's a lot that's still to be learned. The bottom line is Cambridge Analytica certainly is not out of the woods yet.
Not even close. I mean, this is the beginning of an investigation. There are prosecutors flying to other countries to question people. It just seems that, you know, you can shut yourself down and you can say, well, we can't do business because of all the bad reputational things that have happened to us. But, you know, you're still going to have to contend with the law.
Yeah. Matthew Rosenberg, appreciate it. More to come. We have more breaking news. A federal judge in the District of Columbia has just ruled the bank fraud trial against Paul Manafort, President Trump's former campaign manager, can proceed. Now, that case, of course, brought by the special counsel Robert Mueller, a different federal judge has ruled on this today than the one in Virginia who had assailed the Mueller investigation earlier this month. Judge T.S. Ellis said that a parallel bank fraud case against Manafort wasn't really the point. The charges, he said, were really aimed at prosecution or impeachment of the president. CNN's Sarah Murray now has more details. So what was the judge's ruling or reasoning for this ruling today?
Well, look, Manafort is basically trying to make the case that Mueller has overstepped his authority, that he shouldn't be bringing these charges against Manafort. And, you know, these are to do with financial crimes before Manafort was working for the campaign. And the judge was not at all impressed by this argument. She pointed out that, look, we know that Paul Manafort was in the upper ranks of the campaign. We know that he has ties to Russians. We know that he did lobbying work on behalf of Ukrainian politicians. So in part of her opinion today, she wrote the special counsel would have been remiss to ignore such an obvious potential link between the Trump campaign and the Russian government. That's just a taste of sort of how strong her ruling was. Now, as for Paul Manafort, he's still maintaining his innocence in all these charges. A spokesman for Paul Manafort put out a statement today saying Paul Manafort maintains his innocence and looks forward to prevailing in this matter. And as you pointed out, this is just one of the courts where Manafort is arguing.
Right. So explain that, because it is a little bit confusing. As I talked about, the ruling comes on the heels of the other judge earlier this month questioning Mueller's authority to bring these charges. So there's two cases, there's two different courtrooms going on.
That's right. There are two different courtrooms where this sort of theater is playing out. This one was in D.C. And previously, earlier this month, Manafort was making a similar argument in Virginia, again, saying that Mueller has overstepped his authority. And in this case, the judge seemed much more sympathetic to Manafort's argument, essentially going to prosecutors and saying, look, I think that you guys are just using this to go after President Trump, potentially to try to impeach him. I don't think you really care that Paul Manafort committed bank fraud, if that's what you're alleging here. I don't think you really care about these charges. We think this is all about getting after Trump. Now, it's important to note that the judge in this case has not made a ruling yet, but there are starkly different tones in these two different courts where Manafort's trying to argue his case.
Yeah. All right. Thanks very much. Appreciate it. Joining me now to talk about it, CNN Chief Legal Analyst Jeffrey Toobin. Can you just explain to me why two courts? I mean, I know this is stupid, but
no,
why?
It's a very unusual situation. The Mueller office has brought two cases against Paul Manafort, charging similar but not identical crimes.
And one in Virginia and one in the District of
Columbia. One in Virginia, one in D.C.
Why bringing them in different places?
It's not clear to me. It's odd. I think some of it has to do with the law of venue, about where the crimes took place. You can't bring a charge in a jurisdiction where the crime didn't take place. That seems to be it, although venue is sometimes something prosecutors can okay. be a little flexible about. But Manafort made essentially the same motion to dismiss each of the cases, one in Virginia, one in D.C., saying Mueller doesn't have the authority to bring this case. In the argument of the Virginia case, the judge said a lot of things that were unsympathetic to Mueller and sympathetic to
right.
Manafort. Didn't make a ruling, but made noises that were sympathetic to Manafort. Today, the judge in Washington, Judge Jackson, she said this case is fine to proceed to trial, completely rejected all of Manafort's arguments. That ruling is not binding on Virginia, but it certainly will be read by the judge in Virginia, and it is unusual to have judges in identical issues come up with opposite conclusions. So I think the Mueller office has to be not only pleased about the D.C. ruling, but the effect on Virginia
so,
as well.
So the bottom line, at least on the D.C. trial, is it's going to trial.
Right. And I think that's very.
Is there a timeline on that?
It's currently scheduled for the summer, but those tend to once there's a trial date, the judges tend to sometimes be sympathetic to defense requests to delay it. There's also the possibility of one or both parties saying this shouldn't go on during the campaign.
So if the Virginia court as well goes along with what the D.C. court said, is it possible for Manafort to be battling? Will it continue to battle in two courts?
Absolutely.
So can both trials run concurrently?
No, they can't. They can't run concurrently. The judges have to coordinate their schedules. You know, the same person, the same lawyers can't appear in both trials. But it just underlines how difficult Manafort's situation is to pay lawyers for two sets of trials, right, both of which are complicated. And I think the real message of today is that it really increases the pressure on Manafort to plead guilty and cooperate. That's the real, end result the Mueller team wants. Sure, they'll try this case if
they have
to.
Which, in fact, you're agreeing with what the judge in Virginia was saying, which is the truth of this is it's not really these charges, it's getting him to flip.
That's right. But what was so odd about what Judge Ellis said in Virginia, which he did say, you know, you're just trying to get him to flip. That's why prosecutors bring cases all the time. That's what prosecutors do in the United States. They don't do it in other countries necessarily. But our system is very much geared towards flipping people and trying to get them to cooperate. Judge Ellis seemed shocked by that. Judge Jackson in D.C. said, That's how things go.
All right, and so goes. Jeff Toobin, thanks very much. Multiple Republican senators are now calling for a public schedule today, a lunch with the president. Republican senators, seems though no one spoke about McCain and the need for an apology to the president.
No. No, the issue didn't come up.
Didn't come up. Senator John Kennedy said the president talked for 45 minutes about, quote, quite an array of subjects, but not this one. Certainly not an apology. And as you know, the White House aide, Kelly Sadler, called Meghan McCain to apologize, but has not apologized publicly. Now, a source told CNN that she had promised Meghan McCain that she would do so, but she's not. Neither has the president or anyone at the White House. In fact, they're trying to turn this into an issue of leaks and turn away from what it actually is, an issue of just human decency, one that no one decided to broach with the president today, even as some Republican lawmakers are calling for the White House to do the right thing. Here's Senator Susan Collins.
The comment was denigrating and insensitive. John McCain is an American hero. He's a United States Senator, and he's a good friend of mine. The best way for this to be put to rest, and it should have happened immediately, would have been for the White House to issue a public apology to the entire McCain family.
Trump should too, the president himself.
I think it would be helpful if the president made clear that those kinds of comments are not acceptable, rather than criticizing the leaker.
And this came from Senator Jeff Flake.
I don't understand it. Why you just don't apologize and move on? And that would be easier to do. It wasn't the president making the statement, But I'm sure if he asked her to apologize, she would. So I don't know why he hasn't. I really don't.
We saw Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell earlier talking about this. He actually went to Arizona over the weekend to visit Senator McCain. A statement from his office said McConnell didn't want to miss the chance to tell McCain how much his friendship meant to him. Here's Mitch McConnell today.
Well, the person who said that should apologize and should apologize publicly.
So all three of those senators agree McCain deserves an apology. None of them brought it up in that meeting, or no senators brought it up in the meeting, apparently, with the president. They say in front of the cameras, crossing this president is not something many Republicans are willing to do, even in defense of a fellow Republican with a long record of service and brain cancer. Joining me now is Tony Schwartz, who wrote The Art of the Deal with Mr. Trump and is a contributor to the new book, The Dangerous Case of Donald Trump. Tony, thanks for being with us. We know President Trump does not apologize. The Access Hollywood tape is the only really evidence of it. I've talked to him about it. He says he doesn't ask forgiveness from God. He couldn't remember a case of doing that. And he certainly doesn't issue public apologies. It seems like that filters down throughout the whole White House, that message.
Well, first of all, I would imagine that he either directly or indirectly made it clear that he didn't want Sadler to apologize because it would reflect on him. And
it's viewed as weakness?
Without question. That is the heart of it. If you apologize, you are wrong. Look, if you live in a highly binary world, if your worldview is it's black or it's white, it's good or it's bad, if you're not good, you're bad.
You either win or you're a loser.
You win or you lose, all of these, then you only have one choice if you want to end up feeling that you are good. And that's the circumstance that Trump always finds himself in, because to admit and acknowledge, whether it's him or anybody who works for him that might reflect on him, that he's done something wrong is to admit that he's bad. That's his internal experience of it.
It's so interesting to me, though, his idea of strength is so sort of cookie cutter. So, I mean, it's almost cartoonish how he defines strength. And I assume the definition of strength for him is not apologizing. Part of that is never admitting you're wrong.
Well, I don't even think it's a calculation or an analysis or an opinion. I think it's an impulse and an instinct that emotionally, psychologically, he's incapable of it because it's shattering to him to feel that he's wrong.
Did you, in all your time that you spent with him with The Art of the Deal, did you ever hear him apologize for something?
No. No, and it would stun me if he had. It is 30 years later, and it's possible that he did. No, I would say I'm pretty confident he never did. And he would be derisive of someone who did. His father didn't apologize.
His father didn't.
No. I mean, his father was a black and white guy, and he was in the mold of a Roy Cohn, even though they didn't particularly have a relationship. Roy Cohn, who later became somewhat of a surrogate father to Trump and who was clearly a mentor. His attitude was never apologize for anything, and Trump followed from his father to Roy Cohn to himself.
And Roy Cohn, I mean, are you saying that Trump learned from Roy Cohn either from, you know, actually involvement or just watching Roy Cohn? Because Roy Cohn was all about attack, attack, attack.
Yeah, yes, I do think he learned at his knee, if you will, and also at his father's knee. The difference between Roy Cohn's attack, 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 and Donald Trump's, and this is by no means to defend Roy Cohn, is that Roy Cohn was a very bright guy. And he did everything in a highly calculated way, not in an impulsive way.
It was thought out. It was planned.
Absolutely. He had figured out what worked. He was well-educated. He was just plain smart. And he made those choices. He thought it worked. What he lacked, as Trump lacks, was any underlying set of values or principles. So there was no, he was unimpeded. Both Cohn and Trump were unimpeded by guilt or shame.
But with Trump, you're saying, with the president, it's more gut. Roy Cohn, it was more strategic, three-dimensional chess.
It's reactive. It's like almost as if I could imagine that night that the Hollywood Access story began to break and he was being surrounded by his aides and encouraged to apologize. And it would be like he was feeling to himself like, oh, they want to pull my teeth with no anesthetic. That's intolerable.
Well, it's interesting because, I mean, I think it was the Times had reported months ago that the president was even raising the idea to people, friends of his, that maybe that was not his voice on the Access Hollywood tape, which is just an extraordinary
yes.
thing.
Yes. You know, it's so interesting that a wonderful writer named Jonathan Haidt, who maybe has even been on the show, who's written a book actually that I have somewhere here, but he writes about morality. And what he says, and I agree, is that the impulse comes up. He calls it the elephant. The rider is the more thoughtful part of your brain. Mm-hmm. And the impulse comes up, and it dominates. It comes out. And then the brain ends up being used in the service of rationalizing what the impulse has caused you to do. Mm-hmm. So it's the utter misuse and the ultimate misuse of the prefrontal cortex. But we all do it. And Trump does it in extremis.
And again, to me, it's if somebody on the staff then apologizes, like, he views that person as weak.
It's not only that he views that person as weak. There's no question. And everybody is either, in Trump's mind, is either weak or strong, is either, you know, rich or poor, or is either tough or wimpy. But it's also that that person is always reflecting on him, because the only person Trump sees at any given moment truly is himself. So everybody is a reflection of him, for better or for worse. In this case, if there were to be an apology, it would be for worse. Mm.
Tony Schwartz, that fascinating. Thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Coming
up, President Trump today at a memorial for fallen officers spoke about a Border Patrol agent who died in the line of duty. Some Republicans have been saying that he was attacked. We'll have the latest on what investigators believe now happened. Also ahead, the new reason why Meghan Markle's father will reportedly miss the royal wedding. It has nothing to do with some paparazzi photographs. It's something more serious.
Whatever you do to stay healthy, you might be missing something.
Joy in serving his country as a Border Patrol agent. He was extremely proud of what he did. Every day he would go to work and risk his life to keep America safe. He bravely confronted the cartels, the smugglers, the human traffickers, the gangs that threaten our communities. One night last November, Agent Martinez died in the line of duty. It was horrific. It was violent. And he was brave.
Well, Agent Martinez did risk his life every single day and did die in the line of duty. Exactly what happened, however, is still unclear. CNN's Ed Lavandera has more.
In the darkness of a West Texas night last November, Border Patrol agents Rogelio Martinez and Stephen Garland were found severely injured in a culvert while patrolling an area near the remote town of Van Horn, close to the U.S.-Mexico border. Martinez suffered severe head injuries and died hours later. Garland survived but doesn't remember what happened. It didn't take long for a sinister storyline to emerge. Agents with the National Border Patrol Council, the union which has strongly supported President Trump, claimed there was evidence suggesting the agents were savagely attacked by drug runners from Mexico.
These agents didn't get clipped by a truck. They didn't get clipped by a car. They were attacked. It's plain to see that they were attacked.
Texas Republicans pushed the story even harder. The governor and Senator Ted Cruz also described the incident as an attack. And President Trump used the moment to push for a border wall.
We lost a Border Patrol officer just yesterday, and another one was brutally beaten and badly, badly hurt. And we talk about the wall. We're going to have the wall. It's part of what we're doing. We need it.
But the problem with this story is federal investigators don't believe the agents were attacked at all, and it appears to be some kind of accident. This is the culvert where the Border Patrol agents were found. It sits just off of Interstate 10, where cars are flying by at high rates of speed. And if they fell off of this and into the bottom here, it's about a 10-foot drop into a cement bottom. 3 months ago, CNN obtained an internal Border Patrol memo which said that even though it's not clear what happened that night, there was no evidence of a crime. The agents did not have defensive wounds, and the only footprints at the scene belonged to the agents and first responders.
Everybody, you know, they reassure me that, you know, they're going to get to the truth. They're going to get to the truth. But, I mean, here we are weeks later and there's still no answers.
With no clear answers, Rogelio Martinez's fiance tells CNN the ordeal is confusing and made worse by the differing explanations for what could have happened on that night in November.
And Ed Lavandera joins us now. I mean, just horrible what happened to both these officers. Where is the investigation ongoing? Is there going to be an answer?
It is still ongoing, but the latest information we have has really kind of pointed to this being some kind of accident. However, you know, investigators haven't been able to clearly pinpoint exactly what happened, whether or not it was a passing car or some other kind of freak accident that happened out there in that remote area. We just don't know at this point. But they have said all along, and they have been saying a very clear indication from early on, they don't believe that there was anything out there at that scene that indicated any kind of foul play.
All right. Ed Levender, appreciate that. We'll continue to follow it. Up next, an update on how First Lady Melania Trump is doing after her kidney procedure. Dr. Sanjay Gupta joins us. Also, breaking news on another surprise medical procedure. This one reportedly more serious and scheduled for the father of Meghan Markle just days before she's to wed Prince Harry at Windsor Castle.
Sometimes a day at the ballpark is more than just a day at the ballpark.
All military members.
The fact the First Lady is staying at the hospital for another 2 or 3 days, does that tell us anything?
Well, I think that's the biggest open question mark here, Anderson. I've talked to several doctors, doctors who perform this procedure pretty regularly, even looked at some of the data in terms of how long people typically stay in after a procedure like this, this embolization. And, you know, it's most patients go home the same day. It's an outpatient procedure for most patients. Some stay an extra day if they're worried about pain or some other problem. But to stay, you know, four days or so, which it sounds like she'll be staying, maybe staying, it's just unusual. I just don't know what to make of it, not hearing anything more from her office. It could just be out of an abundance of caution.
And this is a dumb question, but how is a procedure different from a surgery?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because people use these terms interchangeably, and terms do matter here. A surgery basically is when you make an incision in the skin, and you're actually going and examining, in this case, the kidney or an organ directly. With this procedure, it's really kind of like a large IV, Anderson, that goes into a blood vessel, and then a catheter is basically threaded to the area right around the kidney. And through that catheter is where this embolization takes place.
So when the First Lady does leave Walter Reed, any idea based on what we know what the recuperation process might be like?
My guess is that she is going to, especially given that most patients go home the same day, when she leaves in a couple, 3 days from now, my guess is she's going to be feeling fine, up walking around, taking care of herself, no problems. There may be a little bit of soreness still, sometimes from the procedure, but that's the type of soreness that is controlled just with some ibuprofen or some Advil or something like that.
All right, Sanjay, thanks very much. We wish you the best.
Of course. Thank you.
Now to the surprise medical procedure that is reportedly expected tomorrow morning for Meghan Markle's father. TMZ is reporting that Thomas Markle has told them he will undergo heart surgery to clear a blockage, repair damage, and put a stent. Now, according to TMZ, Mr. Markle says this is what will, in fact, keep him from walking his daughter down the aisle on Saturday at Windsor Castle when she marries Prince Harry. CNN's Max Foster is in Windsor, joins us with the latest. Max, what do we know about the procedure that Meghan Markle's father is expected to have this week?
Well, this is what he told TMZ. The doctors, will go in and clear the blockage, repair damage, and put a stent into where it's needed. Clearly, he's not going to be well enough after that operation on Wednesday to come here to Windsor to go to the wedding. So we're back, basically, Anson, where we were last night. But he isn't now coming to the wedding, even though earlier we'd heard that he might possibly do that.
Right. I mean, there have been multiple kind of narratives just over the course of the last 24 hours about why exactly he won't be attending the wedding. So just according to TMZ, it is for this health reason.
It is. I think, you know, the problem he's created for himself here is that, you know, yesterday when you and I were talking, what I was told, and I believe this to be true, that Meghan Markle was desperately upset that her father had said that he wasn't be able to come to the wedding. So Harry, you know, as is his way, started blaming himself a bit for this. He feels that all of this pressure he's put on Meghan because of his profile caused all of this pain within the family. So he sent his people out to speak to correspondents like myself to try to send the message out that the media need to give Thomas Markle a break. Then we have the situation that he's gone back to TMZ and said, actually, I've changed my mind. I am going to go to the wedding. And then again, that he's not going to go to the wedding. So they're in the situation where I think, actually, frankly, they're running out of patience with him. Obviously, there's sympathy for his medical condition and the pressure he's under. But he can't keep fueling the media machine when they're trying to calm it down on his behalf.
So how is, A, how is this playing out with the public in Great Britain, but also do we know who is going to walk the bride down the aisle? Because her father was supposed to, at last I'd heard.
Very good question. I mean, I think, you know, I'm in Windsor. I've been here all week. Here, there's a great deal of excitement about the wedding. They want to see the fairy tale unfold in the castle behind me. So they have a lot of sympathy for what Meghan Markle's going through right now with just days to go until her wedding. And it's been thrown into chaos. And she's obviously very upset by it. She has to decide who's going to walk her down the aisle. So a lot of people talking about her mother, Dorian, possibly doing that. Other people suggesting it might be one of Prince Harry's friends, who's also friends with Meghan. Some people suggesting it could be Prince William. Possibly she could go for the Scandinavian route here, because if this happens in Scandinavia, then the bride and groom will go down the aisle together. She's got to deal with that. It's a big question for her. It's quite unsettling for her. And then there's the question of who's going to give the speech on her behalf at the reception as well. But, you know, I'm getting the impression now that she's going to do that speech. Mm. She's going to take control of that, which might free up her mother to prepare for walking her down the aisle.
Interesting. Max Foster, thanks very much. Appreciate it. Quick programming note, I'm going to be traveling to England for CNN's special coverage of the royal wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle. Join me for 360 on Friday night, and I'll be live from Windsor for their special day starting at 4 a.m. on Saturday morning, so set your alarm clocks, get up early. Up next, North Korea threatens to pull out of the summit with President Trump. What it has to do with South Korea when we continue.
I'm Dara Khosrowshahi.
It has to do with domestic politics, reassuring people around him that I'm still a tough guy. I'm not gone soft on the United States and South Korea. Or this is him reacting to pressure that's been put on him by the United States. So far, the U.S. has been putting pressure, saying it's complete denuclearization, complete denuclearization. Trump is going to go for the full deal. And this is him saying, you know what? I've still got skin in this game. I'm still a player here. Trump has threatened that he will walk away from a deal if he's not happy. This is Kim saying, I can do that too. Mm. So one of those two things seem most likely. Now, from the North Korean point of view, this is not an unrealistic expectation that the South would at least tone down these exercises. Yes, they happen every year. Yes, they're supposed to be defensive. But you're calling an exercise Max Thunder. And you're doing it right on North Korea's border, just when relationships between the two countries are going through a period of thaw. It's not unreasonable for them to expect a scaling down, a postponement, a reduction in hostilities.
I see a new game by Activision next year, Max.
Right. That's actually my adult film name. So I'm really in there. Oh, sorry. Wow. Oh, boy. Michael Avenatti is my lawyer.
Right. What do you guys make of this?
I think Bobby's right. I think this is probably more talking to the regime, but I think we should listen too, mm-hmm. which is he didn't change, this is Kim, did not change his stripes. I feel like the president is like a teenager learning to drive. It's flooring the gas and then slamming the brake. And we went from fire and fury to open and honorable. And I don't think either was actually quite right. You know, he's not open and honorable. He's a man who just murdered Otto Warmbier, a completely innocent American college kid. I'm glad he freed these hostages, but you should have never taken them in the first place. I just think a more nuanced, calmer approach. Let me praise him for this.
Shouldn't the president get some credit the rhetoric which all the experts were saying, look, this is terrible and not a good idea. You can make an argument. We are now seeing some movement which we haven't seen before.
Well, I think he should get credit for tonight for not tweeting or commenting at all. Seriously, that's wisdom. That's great. I hope he continues once he watches Fox and Friends in the morning. I still hope he continues
all right,
to shut up. But yes, he does deserve some credit for getting here, but I do think it's way too hurt.
But hold on. The United States has taken a nuanced approach for six decades as the Korean War has not ended. It has now. Listen, there are knowns and unknowns in this equation. What is known is the Korean War is ending. And it's because of President Trump, and that's not my opinion, that's the opinion of South Korea and President Moon and the South Korean leadership. The Korean War is ending. What is also known is Kim Jong-un is no longer, for now, lobbing missiles into the Pacific. Because he either fears or respects Donald Trump or some, you know, mixture of the two. What is also known is he's at least willing to meet. What's unknown is what will come out of this. We don't know. And Donald Trump clearly will not sell the farm.
Years.
He will not sell the farm. Okay, but
I mean, the North Koreans, Brian, the North Koreans have been wanting to meet for No. I mean, every regime.
Decades, yeah.
And they've already said that Trump is getting too much credit for this. Remember from a couple of weeks ago, there was a statement they're pushing back on the idea that Trump was responsible for the thawing.
But not according to South Korea.
Right.
Whether we believe it or not, that's what North Korea wants us to believe. And I think this is part of that narrative, that this is not all, Trump is not calling all the shots here. We're still the active player.
I just want to say, look, we could all agree we want peace, we don't want war. I think what this shows is how ill-prepared the United States is. Let's not forget, we still don't have a U.S. ambassador in South Korea. So we were caught off guard, and we could have, if we had diplomacy there, we would have known a little bit more of what was going on.
Is that really, Rich, because we've had ambassadors there, and we haven't known what's been going on.
But this is a
classic North Korean tactic, though. Their negotiations are based on unpredictability.
Right.
And it's hard to say what exactly this means, but it may be saying, actually, we're going to set the tempo. It may be a sign they want to get into a negotiation over the negotiation. It may be a sign, hey, we have more leverage because actually you want this more than we do.
Yeah.
So I would still expect there to be a summit. I would expect it at least to be superficially successful, because even if Kim is insincere, which I assume, his goal should be to have a good meeting, try to string us along, and try to get concessions before he's done anything significant the way the regime has for 30 or 40 years.
Now, AB, one of the things, I mean, having a meeting between two leaders is one thing, but in a summit, there's a lot of legwork that goes on usually before or after between other people lower level in the government. I mean, there's a lot of work to be done beyond just whatever happens at that one meeting.
Right. And look, I agree with Rich that I don't think this is going to be derailed, and I think it's going to happen. And I think this was sort of gesture politics. It was just a way of saying you're not in control. The United States president and the South Korean president are not in the driver's seat. I'm going to be unpredictable and raise the stakes and insert some tension. He's been so acquiescent, it appears. And so it's important also to remember what Karine points out is that he does have decades of people who've been working on this with his father and grandfather, and the Trump administration is using some experts, but the team has been, there have been some openings, some vacancies. And this is also a quick pace in terms of the calendar. I think it's going to happen, but it's also important, and they go into this mindfully knowing, and the president said, I'll walk away, that just the summit itself can be an end game for Kim Jong-un. I mean, just to be on stage at an equal footing with the U.S. president has been a goal for decades.
I mean, Bobby, that is what multiple regimes, leaders in North Korea have wanted, to be on an equal footing, to have that one-on-one meeting.
They want that legitimacy. In fact, Kim's already, you know, if we step back a little bit, he's already won some of these things. A serving CIA director has never been there. A serving Secretary of State has never gone and shaken hands with his father or grandfather. Those are quite significant. It's only because there's a prospect of a Trump summit that we are thinking that's the biggest prize, but he's already won silver and bronze. He's looking pretty...
Hold on. I really think that you all are so unwilling to give the president any victory on anything that I think you're suspecting.
I don't think I'm saying
reality. I said give him credit. This is not just optics.
The Korean War is ending. That is momentous. I mean, historic. He has stopped sending. I'm not just talking about optics.
But isn't that the rhetoric of it? You can't say the Korean War is ending.
Yeah.
I mean, nothing.
Well, they're negotiating the end of the war. And he has stopped lobbing missiles. Okay, more importantly, right? There are no missiles for now going into the Pacific. Why? Because President Trump applied maximum economic pressure, maximum diplomatic pressure, mainly via China, and, quite honestly, harsh rhetoric. As much as people mocked him for Rocket Man,
guess what? That's all true.
And Kim Jong-un has been forced into a corner, and the idea that he's dictating terms is absurd.
Okay,
we have him in a corner. And we can decide to let him out of that corner, but it's for us to decide.
It's certainly true that Trump usefully intimidated him. Trump usefully intimidated him, and there was significant slack in the sanctions regime, which we tightened up, which was very good. But nothing that's happened so far has not happened before. These sort of North Korea, South Korea summits that are going to talk about ending the war, we've seen it all before. We've seen the North Koreans blow up testing facilities
before. No, we haven't seen them meet the DMZ. That's not true.
Well,
we have not.
These kind
of meetings. That's historic. I mean, don't say that.
Twice the South Korean president has gone to Pyongyang and shaken hands. I was based in Hong Kong for Time magazine in 2007, the first time that happened. The South Korean president won a Nobel Prize because of that. What came of it? Nothing.
What's
nothing at all.
2010. Cessation of missiles.
Cessation
No, that's not a promise. That's reality.
Right. That's happened a lot.
Let's take a break. When we come back, still no apology from the White House after an age-cruel joke about Senator John McCain. Some Republican senators have said there should be an apology. Did they bring it up when they met with the president today? We'll have the answer on that next. Also later, tonight's breaking news in the Mueller investigation, a ruling from a judge about whether he overstepped his legal authority in the Paul Manafort case and whether that case is going to continue. The president met with Republican senators today in Capitol Hill for a lunch meeting. The president spoke for about 45 minutes, according to Senator John Kennedy, about a variety of topics. One thing that did not come up was their colleague, Senator John McCain, and a White House aide's comment that, quote, he's dying anyway. Neither the president or the White House nor the aide have publicly apologized to the senator and his family. Some Republican lawmakers are calling for those apologies, but it didn't come up, apparently, in the meeting today.
No. No, the issue didn't come up.
Well, it didn't come up. Several lawmakers in the room have said that Senator McCain deserves a public apology from the White House or the aide. Back now with the panel. Also joining the conversation is CNN Chief Legal Analyst Jeffrey Toobin. Should anybody be surprised that there hasn't been an apology? I mean, if one thing you know about President Trump is he doesn't apologize except for the Access Hollywood tape, and that certainly seems to filter down.
He does not permit apologies, and the staff knows that, and they are not allowed to make apologies about any mistakes that happen at the White House or anything like these disparaging comments about McCain. What's interesting about today is that by my count, at least 8, I think almost 10 Republican senators have been on the record saying this must happen. And then when faced with him behind closed doors, they didn't bring it up.
Hmm. Or what? Or what? Like, no. What are the Republican senators going to do? As usual, nothing. So, I mean, the idea that, you know, they say Trump should do X, and then he doesn't do it, and then they vote for everything he's for anyway. So this idea that there is any rebellion against Trump for this or anything else is complete.
I didn't say there was.
No,
I'm surprised they would come out and demand this on camera and then in privacy have a lunch and not say what Lindsey Graham said, which was it would be great for your administration if someone could make a statement that said that this was unfortunate. And
then they meekly go back into the corner.
But hold on, I want to second that, because the idea that the Hill Republicans do his bidding, I think, is absurd, and the evidence argues exactly the opposite. The wall would be built completely if the Hill Republicans were Trump's minions on Capitol Hill. In fact, Hill Republicans have been very obstructionist to him, particularly in the Senate, on health care, on the wall. How about
three
foundational
health care?
Well, that's enough. Point is, you're promoting a. This is fake news. If you say that Senate Republicans do whatever Trump wants, the opposite is true.
He didn't say that. How many of his judges have
federal
failed
judges
to get confirmed?
Federal judges have gone through
judges
the GOP tax
how about health care?
I believe the number you're looking for is zero.
Okay. How about the wall? How about
the wall that Mexico was supposed to pay for?
Can we get back to the topic? The President of the United States has a staff member who mocked and disparaged a war hero who's facing cancer. That's appalling. Many of his colleagues, he's beloved, he served 30 years in the Senate. Many of his colleagues said, gee, that's really uncool. But when faced with the president, they folded like a cheap suit. That's not any longer Donald Trump's fault. That's the Republican Party's fault. They're so cowed by this man, you can hear him move. They're completely
over
their souls, their spines, and
various other body parts. Steve, actually, according to the president, the wall is being built.
A portion of it, but nothing like the president wants. He wanted $20 billion and he got
three. But that's not even true that a portion is being built. It's just being rehabbed. The existing wall is being rehabbed. I mean,
a portion is. Look, regarding this issue, you know, as I mentioned to you last night, look, I believe in apologies.
Right, you think you should apologize.
I apologize to my wife about 4 times a day, all right, because I have to, because it's the right thing to do. I think that someone at the White House should apologize for this. Mm-hmm. I do believe that. I know Kelly Sadler, like her. I don't believe she said this with real animus. I think if we heard the context, it wouldn't sound nearly
the
as harsh. For example, the context could be, let's not respond because he's on his deathbed. That would be a much more reasonable I would like to hear.
He didn't even say because he's on his deathbed. That's
here's
not what was reported. That was said.
Donald Trump. You say he never apologizes. That's not true. He does, and he did for the Access Hollywood tape. I think
he renounced that then and said it wasn't even his voice.
Yeah,
The only apology we have, he renounced. He crawfished right away.
Why he is so reticent to apologize is because here we are now. Kelly Sadler, as much as I happen to like her, 99% of America has no idea who she is.
Mainstream media has been fixated on this story for now, I think, day six, while the economy is exploding, while peace is perhaps a real reality in the Korean Peninsula, while real things are going on in the world, while he keeps one campaign promise after another, what are we talking about? A mid-level staffer who said something crass. I think that's why he has such revulsion for the media, understandably so, because they want to major in the minors and pick
on
whatever they can pick on.
Her colleagues had such revulsion for her comments that they leaked it out of the meeting. Multiple colleagues.
They leak everything.
And then after that, because the White House refused to calm this story down and drags it into day six, it is not the media, as a result of the White House statements from the podium combined with Republican senators saying it must be apologized for, it is a six-day story.
I mean, you know better than anyone, Steve, that this White House drags out things and makes them a story more than they would otherwise
right.
be. I mean, we would not be discussing this.
I'm conceding to you. I think this is an unforced error. I think that we should have been done with this story. Right. But I'm also explaining, as someone who knows the president and who understands him, and by the way, not understands just him, but the 2016 movement, the media is so antagonistic and so ready to harp on a minor issue that I think explains his reticence.
But this comes long before. I mean, during the campaign, I asked him multiple times. He doesn't ask forgiveness of God, which he has talked about multiple times, even though he's been embraced by the evangelical community. I've asked him when was the last time he apologized during the campaign. Couldn't remember. There was the Access Hollywood thing. But to say that this is a reaction to something he's discovered in the White House. I mean, this is a lifelong thing.
But the thing is, Anderson, there are about three dozen times most of us would have thought during the campaign would have served his interest to apologize.
I agree.
There are about three dozen times people in suits who've done this for a living, yes, to the extent there were any in the campaign, ran in and said, Mr. President, or it was Mr. Trump, you need to apologize for this. And he didn't. And it worked for him.
So that suggests this is about efficacy, not ethics. Right? See, he's unconcerned with what the right thing is. He just, apparently it works for him to never apologize after attacking a war hero.
Well, we should say, in fairness to Kelly Sadler, she did apologize to Meghan McCain. And I think it's because of this White House policy and what comes from the top. They can't apologize publicly.
But apparently she did say, I mean, according to the reporting, that she would do it publicly.
Yeah. Well, then I think there's probably some effort to say no. You can't apologize publicly.
And that's not the media that's really, again, I think the White House drags out the story. But it's that Meghan McCain was told she was going to get a public apology, and she didn't. She announced that publicly. It's that Republican senators, almost a dozen or 10 of them, have said this must happen. And that's not the media focusing on John McCain's family's hurt feelings. That's actually people calling for an apology
But the media is fixated on a story that no one in America cares about.
Then they can turn the channel. John McCain's family?
Look, no, about a mid-level staffer saying something crass.
No one cares.
I have an aversion
to anyone here saying, like, what America thinks. We're sitting here on West 58th Street. What the hell do we know about
America? You know why? Because I live in the Midwest, and I worked for the Trump campaign, Jeffrey Toobin, and I knew he was going to win when everyone at this table and everyone at every newsroom in New York and Washington, D.C. said he had no chance. I knew it because I saw the pain and the anxiety that was out there in America, and I saw the way Donald Trump spoke to them. So I know very well, actually, I might be the best person to ask other than the president himself.
And so mocking a dying man...
My finger on the pulse of America.
Insulting a man who's fighting for his life somehow ameliorates the pain of the forgotten middle class.
But my point is, a mid-level staffer saying something crass in the White House is not relevant to the life of a middle-class voter who elected Donald Trump. What is relevant to them? Rising wages, an improving economy, more security.
I get all that, but what about just like simple friggin' human decency and being like a decent person? Like you said, you should apologize. Why can't we have people who just are decent human beings who said, you know what, yeah, I made a mistake. I apologize all the time for stuff to friends and family, just like you said. I mean, there is just a thing to be said for human decency, and maybe it's not popular, and maybe it's not what his base wants to hear, but they're very decent people, too, and I bet they apologize in their own lives as well.
And I wish they had, but my point also is, at the same time, it's unbelievable almost to me that here we are in prime time on CNN with all that's going on in the world, in Israel, in Korea, with the job market, and we're talking about
Well, we're actually talking about many things. We've actually talked about North Korea. We're actually talking about Gaza. I'm just interviewing Tom Friedman later on in the program. So we're spending plenty of time on it. Yeah. It just seems, again, it's emblematic of a larger issue in this White House. It goes beyond this one, what you say is a mid-level staffer. Yeah. And I think that's interesting.
Can I just say that, look, we're talking about the White House here, which is the highest office in the land. Our children are watching, right? This is the President of the United States. He is supposed to set a tone. Young kids should be looking up to him. And what we're seeing is he's created this incredibly toxic environment in the White House where, A, people, staffers are saying whatever crude, awful things that they are that they feel that they can say because the President says it. And also they're fighting each other. They're leaking on each other. This is not what we're supposed to be seeing from the White House. And I think that is the problem. It's the behavior. It's what's coming out of the White House.
If you refuse to apologize about this, I mean, it's and you lie about little things, you know, what about the bigger things?
Hold on, you can't just throw the lie in there. I hear this all the time.
Millions of illegal immigrants voted in California, and that's why Hillary Clinton won the popular vote.
If we want to dig into that, there is evidence of widespread voter fraud. There is.
Wait a minute, really? There's no evidence. You should be on that commission that no longer exists there because they couldn't find anything.
They had to disband the commission because they couldn't find any proof.
You believe millions of illegal immigrants voted, and that's why Hillary
Clinton. I have no idea how many did, but I do know this. Illegals do vote, clearly. The president has said repeatedly
millions voted, and that's why Hillary Clinton. I mean, the stupid crowd size at the inaugural, which nobody would be focusing on and reporting about had it not been issue number one for this White House and, you know, Sean Spicer being pushed out there. On a Bataan death march to yell and scream and destroy his credibility so that he's now, you know, opening up exhibits at Madame Tussauds Wax Museum. And by the way, I have a doll at I'm at Wax Museum, so I'm not bad-mouthing Madame Tussauds. But, you know, I don't know.
We gotta go see the West. Anyway,
thanks very much. Appreciate everybody's perspective. Much more to get to tonight. We also have breaking news tied to the Mueller investigation. Federal judge today ruling the bank fraud case against Paul Manafort. President Trump's former campaign manager can proceed. I'll talk about that with the author of the new profile of Mr. Mueller that it has its roots in. It's all about his background in the Marine Corps. We'll be right back. Can proceed. The trial is scheduled for September. This Thursday will mark a year since Mueller's appointment became official. Joining me with more insight on Mueller himself is Garrett Graff. He's contributing editor for Wired magazine, who's out with a new profile of the special counsel, which is on newsstands May 22nd. So, Garrett, I mean, it's a really fascinating look at Robert Mueller that you have in Wired. You write that in order to understand who he is, really what defines him, you've got to go all the way back to his time serving the Marine Corps during the Vietnam War. Can you just explain how so?
Yeah, so the profile focuses on the year that he spent in Vietnam, 6 months of that in combat right along the DMZ, 1968-1969, which was really sort of the formative experience for Bob Mueller. You can see a lot of the traits that he has as FBI director, as special counsel, sort of coming out of his Marine training. The extreme discipline, the extreme focus on the mission. He went through very intensive training through the Marines with Officer Candidate School, Army Ranger School, Airborne Jump School, actually, and then spent 6 months of intense combat in Vietnam during some of the worst fighting that the U.S. forces faced in the entire Vietnam War.
Yeah, I mean, 68, 69, critical years. What were you able to find out just how consistent his leadership style has been, whether it's in the military, the FBI, now special counsel?
Well, it was really funny. I've interviewed a lot of his staff from the FBI, a lot of the prosecutors he's worked with over the years, and I went back and was interviewing ultimately 8 Marines that I found who served with him in the hotel company of the 2nd Battalion, 4th Marine Regiment in Vietnam. And they all said almost exactly the same thing that anyone else has said about Bob Mueller ever since, that he's incredibly focused, he was incredibly driven, that he was sort of up every night checking the patrols, checking the observation posts, sort of making sure that he knew where everyone was, and that he was, in fact, sort of in many ways working harder than almost any of the Marines under him. And I dove deep into the Battle of Mudder's Ridge, December 11, 1968, where Bob Mueller received the Bronze Star with Valor for helping to rescue a mortally wounded Marine. And I actually found the other Marine in Texas that he helped to rescue that day in battle.
They also talk about him under pressure, what he's like.
Yeah, and this is sort of one of the things that really you see how important Vietnam was to the Bob Mueller that we know today, which is Mueller considers himself incredibly lucky to have survived Vietnam. Many others didn't that he served with. The Marine who actually inspired him to join, his Princeton classmate David Hackett, was killed in Vietnam just as Bob Mueller was beginning officer candidate school. And that this was a time where Mueller sort of feels incredibly grateful for having survived. And he also feels that sort of no pressure that he has ever faced since being a Marine in combat in Vietnam compares to the stress of leading men in combat. And sort of one of his sort of dark jokes lines after 9/11 when he was leading the FBI was even under all of that stress, he would say, I'm still getting more sleep than I ever did in Vietnam. Mm.
You also point out in your interview just how different the paths are that Mueller and President Trump have taken throughout their lives, which is quite obvious.
Yeah, and this is sort of one of the almost Shakespearean aspects of this tale. As you mentioned, Thursday, the one-year anniversary of Mueller's appointment as special counsel. You know, these are two men started lives in very similar ways, and their paths diverged dramatically at Vietnam. Mueller going off to serve, Donald Trump taking five deferments.
Yeah, Garrett Graff, it's a fascinating piece. Look forward to more people reading in Wired. Thanks very much. Up next, more of my conversation with New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman about what Nikki Haley said today about the violence in the Middle East and the overall Trump foreign policy. It's also breaking news linked to the royal wedding, the new reason why Meghan Markle's father won't take part, at least now, in the special day this Saturday. It has nothing to do with some paparazzi photos. It's far more serious. We'll take you to Mexico, where Mr. Markle lives, for the latest.
One year ago today, Mom started searching for her words. And my brother Ray.
There's more breaking news, and this is tied to the royal wedding just days away. Turns out there's a new reason why Meghan Markle's father apparently won't walk her down the aisle on Saturday. It has nothing to do with photos that were staged with paparazzi. Instead, TMZ says it talked again with Thomas Markle, and he's now saying that he has to undergo heart surgery tomorrow morning. According to TMZ, doctors will clear a blockage, repair damage, and put in a stent. Leila Santiago is in the Mexican town where Mr. Markle lives, joins us now. So I understand you went to the hospital to find Markle. What did you find out? What can you tell us?
Well, Anderson, we actually talked to the assistant director of the hospital. She confirmed that he is no longer there. And so we are kind of going off of these reports of what he's been quoted as saying, that this is no longer a back and forth between both families, but that this is now a health issue. You know, as we were at the hospital, we talked to actual several doctors, and they are saying that this is now medical. Of course, there has been that back and forth, and he's been quoted as saying he wants to now walk his daughter down the aisle. It's certainly a historic moment for the world and also for this father. But what we know is what's been reported by TMZ, that there is a possible surgery tomorrow morning that was not confirmed by the hospital. They are citing privacy reasons right now, but this has been something that's been in the news, and now it's certainly taking a turn just days before the royal wedding.
So I guess if it's like stent surgery, maybe he could go to the hospital tomorrow. You're in the neighborhood he lives in now. Are people talking about him at all?
What's been somewhat surprising is that for this to be such a small area, not a lot of people seem to know who he is. It's a gated community. It's beachfront property. There are cobblestone streets. And when we talk to neighbors, many from the expat community, a lot of Americans that are here, many people seem to know about him, but I haven't found anyone who's actually talked to him. So it seems he sort of keeps to himself. He's not answering the door right now. But what people are aware of is that he's here, so much so that there are actually paparazzi camped outside his door. And when we talked to some of them, they actually told us they've been here for weeks, but no sign of him as of today. And of course, that's understandable given what could be some very serious medical conditions.
Are any of the expats that you're talking to, is there interest in the royal wedding there?
Yeah, I actually asked a few people. I said, are you guys going to be watching this? And they said no. So I spoke to one neighbor who she was so self-proclaimed in the know in this community. And she said that everyone seems to know that there's this buzz about royalty, but there wasn't much interest in terms of watching the wedding or getting to know him or looking for him. One person said that she had heard he was in a store nearby earlier this week. He was described as being very friendly, but, you know, it seems to be more media, more photographers, people who were just trying to see what the next move is for Mr. Markle in this area of Mexico, as his daughter is very far away making wedding plans.
Lilith, appreciate it. Thanks very much. Reminder, I'll be traveling to England for CNN's special coverage of the royal wedding. You can join me live Friday night on 360 from there. I'll also be live from Windsor for their special day starting at 4 a.m. on the West Coast on Saturday morning, so I hope you join us for that. Just ahead, more of my conversation with New York Times correspondent Thomas Friedman. Funerals were held today throughout Gaza for those killed in yesterday's violence, with Palestinian officials.
Just like diplomatic pornography from beginning to end. Let's start with Hamas in Gaza. I mean, that was an act of human sacrifice. I'm sorry, when you throw thousands of your youth, the flower of your youth, against an Israeli fence, supposedly to get into Israel, some of them surrounded by armed Hamas fighters, it was inevitable that a lot of people were going to get killed. Israel was not going to open the border to them. And Hamas knew that, and this was entirely designed by Hamas to distract the attention of the world, not to mention the Middle East.
And Hamas controls what happens in Gaza. I mean,
absolutely. They're totally in control. And this is their answer to failed leadership to turn Gaza into some kind of decent, flourishing state, which they could have done. They had a choice to do that before all these blockades began, and they chose not to. And they have a lot to answer for. On the other side, you know, I don't begrudge Israelis defending themselves against people charging their border, not carrying exactly a peace map either. But at the same time, you have to ask Israelis, Hamas is the bad Palestinian leadership. What have you been doing with the good Palestinian leadership in the West Bank? Mahmoud Abbas. Where's the Israeli peace initiative there? Where's the Israeli imaginative, creative solution? What is Bibi's peace plan? Neither Hamas nor Bibi have any peace plan on the table right now. And so the whole thing is just a tragedy. It's two bald men fighting over a comb.
So when two bald men fighting over a comb, is that what he said?
Yes.
I'd never heard that analogy. Yeah. When you hear Jared Kushner basically saying that you know, peace is possible, peace is can be at hand, does that ring true to you at all?
Not in the least. You know, one of the most stupid statements that was said yesterday at that embassy event, which was really just a Republican midterm pep rally disguised as a diplomatic event. Let's be clear, with their evangelical preachers, right-wing, you know, Jewish funders, far-right Jewish rabbis there. This was meant basically to fire up the far-right religious base of the Republican Party. This had nothing to do with diplomacy. But to say that us moving the embassy to Jerusalem is the first step toward peace is such stuff and nonsense, Anderson. What would a real American president have done if he wanted to actually use the embassy move as a step toward peace? Here's what he would have done. He would have come to Bibi Netanyahu and said, Bibi, the Prime Minister of Israel, here's what I'm ready to do. You've always coveted the U.S. embassy being moved from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem and recognizing Jerusalem as your capital. We're ready to do that on one condition, Bibi. You're going to freeze all Israeli settlements in densely populated areas of the West Bank to preserve that zone there beyond the Israeli settlement blocks for a two-state solution. That's what he would have said. I will trade you this embassy move, which you covet, for that step, which will advance the peace process.
That would have been the art of the deal.
Trump did the art of the giveaway. Because if Trump had done that, He could have then come to Mahmoud Abbas and say, the Palestinian leader, look, I know you don't like this embassy move, but look what I got you. I got you something Obama never got you. I got a freeze on Israeli settlements, okay? Then he could have gone to the Arab world and said, look what I've done. I've advanced the process. I've done something hard. Now I want you guys to do something hard. I want you to accept some Israeli tourists. I want you to give some interviews with Israeli journalists. He could have had real leverage. Instead, Trump gave away the most valuable diplomatic real estate in the Middle East treasure box of the United States, and he gave it away for free. Believe me, in Jerusalem, they are laughing at him. In the Arab world, they are laughing at him. They can't believe what a sucker he was to take that bait and give this away for free when he could use it. He could have used it for leverage to have truly advanced the peace process.
Just lastly, I want to ask you about the continued refusal from the White House to apologize publicly for Kelly Sadler's remarks about Senator McCain. Vice President Biden said last week that with those comments that decency has hit rock bottom with this administration. Do you agree with that? I mean, is this rock bottom?
Yeah, I mean, it's just it's sort of just the most basic thing that no one should ever have to tell you or ask you. I would think this woman herself would have said, you know, boy, looking at that tweet, as often people do when they make a statement or a tweet, I'm sorry, hers was a statement, not a tweet, in the cold light of day, you know what, I really feel bad about that. The fact that she couldn't say that, that she wasn't allowed to apologize, that the White House kept explaining why she didn't have to apologize, this isn't politics. This is basic human decency about a man who truly is an American hero. And it's just people who have lost their way.
Tom Friedman, appreciate your time. Thank you, Tom.
Thanks.
Up next, we remember Tom Wolfe, one of the great American writers of the 20th century.